Hello and welcome everyone, I'm James Murphy, and welcome to MCoding, where we try to get just a little bit better at programming every episode. Here's a trap that every single Python programmer will fall for at some point in their career. There's pretty much no setup, all I've got is a small class with a class variable count, a getter, and a setter. We create an instance of the class and print the count just as a control. Then, instead of using our setter, we manually reach in and try to change the count, and then we print it. Couldn't get much simpler of an example than that, right? So what do you think it'll print when I run this main function? I'd give you a minute to think about it, but it seems like the answer should be very obvious. The first print statement should print 0, that's the default class variable, and the second should print 42. But when we actually run the code, we see 0 printed both times. But there's what, 11 lines of code here? What could I possibly be doing wrong? If you don't already understand what's going on, the frustration of a bug like this...
This is outrageous. It's unfair. How can you be on the council and not be a master?
No, I'm not using a non-ASCII lookalike character or some other thing to trick your eyes, but yes, it does have something to do with the name of the variable. In particular, it has everything to do with these two leading underscores. If you just named the variable count instead of underscore underscore count, you would get the output that you were probably expecting in the first place. So something funny is going on with the underscores. But if I used the setter, everything would have worked fine. It was only when I tried to directly reach into the object that it didn't work. And to add to the confusion, the value 42 is in there. When I directly set the value of the count, and I print it out by directly grabbing its value, we do see the 42. It's just the call to getCount that still returns 0. To figure out what's going on, let's print the dictionary of this object after setting the count with both methods. Very surprisingly, if you're not aware of this feature, the dictionary contains two different count variables. One of them is the one that we intended to set, and the setter apparently set this variable. And likewise, the getter appears to be getting that weird variable, not the variable that we set in our code. Well, let me introduce you to the questionable feature behind all of this confusion, private name mangling. Basically, if you're inside a class and you name a variable with two leading underscores, then Python will replace all uses of that variable with a mangled version of that variable. The reason for doing this is to sort of support private access specifiers like they have in other languages like C++ and Java. Suppose I'm building a GUI library and I have a base widget class. I keep a count of all the widgets and increase it whenever I create a new one. I also use the count to give each widget a unique ID. But there are going to be tons of different widgets. Text boxes, labels, buttons. But in some subclass like this button, I might also have some kind of a count. In this case, the button's count means something totally different. The button is counting how many times it's been clicked, whereas the count in widget was like the total number of widgets that had been created before this button. But maybe I have a whole class hierarchy of widgets. And I didn't write all of them. Most of them were written by a mix of 10 different open source developers. And of course, anyone that uses the library is free to create their own widgets. Because of this automatic private name mangling that happens, there's no conflict here. All uses of this count are automatically replaced with this underscore widget count, whereas all usages of this count get replaced with button count. Because of the private name mangling, the author of the button class doesn't need to know or care about the variables and private implementation details of the widget class. Everything just works and there's no conflict. At least, that's how it's supposed to work in theory. But in reality, this picture comes with a lot of asterisks. The first, very important asterisk here is that Python does not have private variables. All variables in Python are public. This private name mangling just changes the name of the variable. It doesn't actually prevent anyone from accessing it. So if you know how name mangling works, you can still reach inside the class and change anything that you like. The intention of name mangling is to prevent accidental reusing of variables, not purposeful modifications by a nefarious class author. The The second asterisk is that the rules for how name mangling works and which variables it applies to are pretty weird. Python does this name mangling if your variable starts with two underscores. Unless it also ends with two underscores, then it's not mangled. Including if your variable is just two or three underscores. And it does this for all identifiers, including local variables. So if you were to look at the local variables of this function, you would see this. Including, for some reason, imports. Unless the import has a dot in the name. And it doesn't just do this on self and local variables, it does it on any usage of a variable name of this form. And the mangling is done based on the class where the code is defined in, not the class of the object. So this statement will try to set this underscore a version of the x variable, even if b isn't an instance of a, because this init function was defined inside of the a class. It's going to use a here. But it doesn't just use the class name. If you add underscores to the beginning of the class, that doesn't change the mangling. So even if you have a bunch of underscores at the beginning, or more realistically, one underscore at the beginning, the mangled name will still just have one underscore. Unless the class name is only underscores, then nothing is ever mangled. If you're interested, here's a Python implementation of how the mangling would actually work based off of the given class name and identifier. And if you're looking for the actual CPython implementation, then you're looking for this PyMangle function. Don't worry, I'm not actually going to go over the C code. But the one thing that I do want to take away from this is actually the name of the file this is in. It's called compile.c. That's right, as if it wasn't already confusing enough, name mangling actually happens at compile time. Yes, Python is compiled and it is also interpreted, and the name mangling happens at compile time. So that means if I have this get count example like at the beginning, the usage of count here isn't mangled because it's not inside the class definition, and we see zero just like at the beginning of the video. But if I had defined this get count function outside of the class and then assigned it at runtime, then because when this function was compiled, it was not inside of a class, this usage of self-count doesn't get mangled, and therefore we see 21 instead of 0. So literally just moving where the function was defined can change the behavior. That means in any class, depending on this private name mangling, you can't use many of the dynamic features of Python. No dynamically created methods, metaclasses, or decorator magic. That's not to say those things can't work, but it just becomes incredibly, incredibly confusing in order to make it work. If you want to stay safe and not worry about it, you're pretty much limited to features of static languages. Which is not completely bad. In fact, I recommend that, especially for larger projects, you self-impose a lot of the restrictions that static languages force on you. But that's besides the point. Just be aware, if you're using mangled names, there is a very high chance that other developers, including yourself in the future, will be confused by what's going on. In order to get a feel for when and how Python does this mangling, and to verify that it actually does happen at compile time, not at runtime, I highly recommend you check out Compiler Explorer. For Python, it shows you the bytecode output of your module. You don't need to understand all the bytecode in order to see what's going on here. Put in a recognizable constant so you can find where that corresponds to in the bytecode. Very nearby, notice we have this store attribute, and there we see it, a mangled name. You can see how if we don't meet the requirements of a mangled name, like just having a single underscore, then the mangling doesn't happen. Same thing if we had two trailing underscores, no mangling. We can use this to see that the mangling still happens even if we're just using a local variable. And we can see that it still happens even if we have a deeply nested dotted name. Any use of this identifier will get mangled as long as we're inside the class. But if we're not inside a class, look for that constant here, then the name doesn't get mangled. Please try this yourself, check out all the different cases of variable names and class names and whatever, and see for yourself when and where the mangling happens. My favorite, absolutely cursed case of this is this. Of course, I've literally never seen an actual module that's prefixed with two underscores, but just so you can see what the compiler does. We can see Python does not mangle the name of the module, but it does store the module under a mangled name. But if we just import a double underscore module, then both the stored name and the imported name are mangled. And I guess it's mostly just curiosity at this point. Even I wouldn't do something this cursed. Now that we understand that name mangling happens at compile time, and after a brief break to calm down, I just wanted to address what's usually the most common question, and that's, how does name mangling work with getattr and setattr? Mangled names are just names at runtime, so if you want to use getattr and setattr, you need to just manually mangle the name yourself. And additionally, mangling does not apply inside strings. It only applies to identifiers. So think variable names and dotted names. If you use getattr or setattr and forget to mangle the name, you're probably going to get an error or set the wrong attribute. So finally, we need to address the elephant in the room. And that is, because of the confusion and complexity of name mangling, do people actually use private name mangling in practice? And should you use private name mangling in practice? In my actual experience programming in Python, I pretty much never use this, and I pretty much never see it in anyone else's code either. So what do I see? The most common thing that I see is single underscore variable names. Now, different people will tell you that a single underscore prefix means that a variable should be treated as a private variable, or a protected variable, or an implementation detail, and I'm not going to argue about the technical definition of what it should be called. Suffice it to say that the convention and the popular unspoken rule is that an underscore prefix variable means don't touch me. If the author of the class meant for you to be able to change it, they would give you a way to do that, often through getters and setters. Rarely, I do see this dunder form of an attribute to mean private. But actually, I more often see that as a public kind of magic attribute, more like a dunder len or a dunder stir. These are typically not private. It's very common and expected for a class to override these. But the problem is that these approaches don't actually solve the original issue that we had. Remember, we had a hierarchy of widgets, and we didn't want someone writing a widget to have to understand the implementation details and avoid the variable names of all of the parent classes. If I just use single underscore prefixes in my variables, that's certainly clear to readers of my code that this is an implementation detail, you're not supposed to touch it. But in order to know what all those attributes are that I shouldn't touch, I need to end up reading all the source code of all of my parent classes. Otherwise, how do I know that my parent class doesn't have their own don't touch me variable? And so you have a choice, a trade-off. You could use a single underscore and force that every class that inherits from you needs to know the implementation details of your class, or you could use private name mangling. That way, people that want to subclass your class don't have to worry about any of your implementation details, but you pay the price in terms of using this confusing feature, and you lose some of that ability to use Python's dynamic capabilities. Or, and this is also a very questionable idea, you could manually mangle the names. Subclasses don't have to know about your implementation, there's no unexpected, hidden, or confusing side effects, but your code looks horrible and your coworkers hate you. Honestly, it's a trade-off you need to just decide for yourself. But full disclosure, in the wild, the most common approach is to use the single underscore and to just hope subclasses don't clobber your implementation details. If you're very good about keeping your classes defined as if they were statically typed, then you could also write a linter rule to help you. But in any case, go forth and decide for yourself. As always, thank you for watching and making it to the end. If you enjoyed my video, please do subscribe, and if you especially enjoyed it, please consider becoming a patron or donor. Thanks to all my patrons and donors for their support. Don't forget to slap that like button an odd number of times. I'll see you next time.